This evening, before we pray, we'll consider the Word of God briefly on the topic Evangelism in 2021. Evangelism in 2021. You may be wondering why the topic Evangelism in 2021. Evangelism is not a new topic to any of us in this platform. We have had evangelism maybe in our churches, and since we joined this ministry, we have heard about evangelism. So why evangelism in 2021? Is anything new about evangelism again? Or is there a different thing about evangelism that has to do with the year 2021? Not necessarily different, but just some few things that will be pointed out to modify our way of evangelism such that we reach out with the gospel of Christ to the people in a more effective way. The word of God itself is not modified, of course, cannot be modified, we won't modify it, but the method at which we reach out. You know, when you do the same thing the same way, you keep getting the same result. And that's why sometimes we see little success, or sometimes even no success in our evangelism. And sometimes we see the church from January to December, 365 days in a year, no single member is added to the church. That is obviously not the will of God. I listened to a servant of God who said the minimum growth of a church should be 365 people in a year. That's minimum. To have said the church did not grow, that means at least 365 people came to the church in 1 year. Because going by the Bible, in Acts of the Apostles, the Bible said the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. That means the minimum added to the church should be at least one person. But these days we see in a church, a year will come and go, no single member is added to the church. The church is rather growing biologically. People getting married and having children, but not by people being saved. So that when you travel for some months, you come back to your church, to your location, if at all you see a new face, sometimes it's a member of the same ministry that relocated from another location and came to that place and has joined the church. But it will be difficult to point out that this person got born again and joined the church. So this tells us that we have to change some pattern, and God will help us to understand and apply a pattern by the leading of the Holy Spirit that will bring fruits to our evangelistic outreach in Jesus' name. Let's open our Bibles to Mark chapter 16, Gospel according to Saint Mark chapter 16. It's a familiar verse, the Great Commission, Mark chapter 16. If you are there, I'll read from verse 15 and verse 16, then I'll jump to verse 20. Mark chapter 16, I'll read verse 15 and verse 16. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Verse 20, and they went forth. Now in verse 15, Jesus Christ said, go ye into all the world. And in verse 20, and they went forth. That instruction remains valid. That commandment remains valid. Go ye. And what did the disciple do? They went forth. That is obedience without delay. And the Bible says, and they went forth and preached everywhere. Jesus had said, go ye into all the world. All the world is everywhere. And in verse 20, immediate obedience. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord walking with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. This is a great commission, and this commandment remains valid. And as long as this life exists, as long as the trumpet has not yet sound, it remains valid. The greatest work we can do for God is evangelism and soul winning. That is the greatest work. that we can do. Pastoring a church is good. Singing in the choir is very, very good. Ushering in the church is very good. But the greatest is that you win a soul to Christ. You reach out to a soul and you preach and the soul gets born again. Other ministries we do in the church are maintenance ministry. The soul's blood, we maintain them by ministering to them in songs, by ministering to them in teaching the word of God, which are all very, very important. But they must not replace that going out to preach the gospel. Which you read the Bible, the rewards in the book of Revelation that we will receive, the crowns that we will receive in heaven. There is no crown that can be given to us for any other achievement in this life greater than that of winning souls. Nobody will receive a crown in heaven because he had so many degrees, he went to so many universities. You know, that is only valid in the world. That they will say, oh, this person was well educated. I read a post somewhere, I think in social media, so I can't remember. I read it somewhere. Oh, yeah, someone showed it to me. The man had died. I think he was a professor or so, or a PhD holder, I can't remember. So somebody was commenting about the death and said, oh, Mr. So that date the rest as so all lost is a crown because of the number of this you had while on earth, but there will be crowns for soul winning. So the greatest work we can do for God is the work of evangelism, reaching out to the world. So as I said, why the topic evangelism in 2021? By the grace of God, I'll just point out some few means that we can apply, that I pray we apply this year and try to like spice up our evangelism, spice up the method by which we use, so that we're not left with the traditional way of taking the Bible, and usually a big Bible, then go from house to house, knock at this door, greet and say, we come to preach the word of God, can you let us in? And we keep moving from house. Yes, we have been doing that, not as if it's outdated or it's not working or it's not good or so. But sometimes when you maintain that very traditional method for long, you look at the fruits. You have been using that method. What are the fruits? Who are the people you can point into the church and say, yes, this came into that method? Yes, you may find some. When you discover that, you know, as we use a particular method, people develop thick skins towards that. That when you knock and they see you with your huge Bible, they just ease. They just say, these people have come again, because that's how it has always been. And the one who tried to allow you to talk is waiting for you to finish. So that, thank you very much, welcome, thank you very much. And he just wants you to just finish and go. While some, they are tired of seeing that. They will just tell you, please, I'm busy, or I'm going out, or something. So we need to apply some newer techniques. Just as we are using this platform now, you know, this was not there before the pandemic. But as the pandemic came, we had to adjust and start using technology to reach out to the world. We had to start having a way of meeting. It's a new thing. It was not there. People who had passed away, passed on from like 5-10 years ago, didn't use this method, didn't use this medium of reaching out to the gospel. So we must apply some specific methods, and the aim is to reach out to souls, to win souls for the kingdom. As I said, that is the greatest task we can do for God, for our Savior. Number one, we must start by targeting our family members. I'll read John chapter 1. John, Gospel according to St. John, chapter 1, I'll read from verse 35 to verse 42. John chapter 1 from verse 35. If you are there, I will read John chapter 1, verse 35. Again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following, and said unto, Jesus turned and saw them following, and said unto them, "What seek ye?" They said unto him, "Rabbi," which is to say, being interpreted, "Master, where dwellest thou?" He said unto them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the tenth hour. One of the two which had Jesus spake and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first finded his own brother Simon. That was his first convert. You have followed Jesus maybe for the past 5 years, or 10 years, or 20 years, or 30 years. Have you ever preached to your brother? Have you ever preached to your sister? Have you ever preached to your parents? Maybe they are there in the village serving idols, worshiping idols, and you are in the city. You are happy you are born again, you are in the city. But you never think about their souls. No, when you don't think about their eternity, when you don't think about their souls, you will not be moved to preach to them. All you do is, at the end of the year or after 2-3 years, you travel to the village, you buy bags of rice, things in Nigeria, we call them Saraba, and you take and give them, oh, they're happy, our son from the city has come, our son from the city has come, and all those things, and you give them, and they welcome you 2 days, you zoom off again. You have never opened your mouth to preach to them. This year, make up your mind, you preach to all your brothers one by one. Every single one of your siblings, you preach to your parents, make up your mind. But how will you preach to them? Will they listen to you? Of course, they won't listen to you if you are not a true Christian. You know, it's your family members that will tell us whether you are a Christian or not. And if you don't live the life of a Christian, it will be difficult for you to preach to them. It's easier to preach to people who don't know you than preaching to people who you grew up with. You may say, yeah, we grew up with, we are familiar and all those things. But once you get born again, there's a change of life. They know that this one, he used to be this, now he's no more. He has changed. He's now born again. His salvation is true. And by the time you sit and open the Bible, they will listen to you. Look at Andrew. He heard about Jesus Christ. John introduced him to Jesus Christ, and he followed Jesus. And the Bible said in verse 41, he first finded his own brother, his brother Simon, first. That was the first thing. So this year, let's focus on our family members. Don't be a lone ranger in terms of being born again in your family. Are you happy that in your whole family you are born again? You are the only one born again. In your whole family, are you happy? You are the only one on the way to heaven. Are you happy? How do you feel telling people, "My family, I'm the only one born again"? They are all idol worshippers. Are you saying that out of achievement? You see it as an achievement. Or you are saying it with sorrow in heart. Oh, I wish my parents could be born again. I wish my brothers and sisters could be born again. Or some of us, maybe we don't even care. We just, all we know about them, we tag them as people who want to kill us. We have what we call grandiose deletion of persecution. You see your brother as the person after your life. Your uncle, your sister, your cousin as somebody who hates your prosperity. Maybe because he's not born again, that's all. Or maybe because he's of the opposite religion. You just feel this one and you just cut off from the people. 1 year you never message. You never call. You don't just care about their souls. No. This year, let's change pattern. Start with your family members. As Andrew did, the Bible says he first finded his own brother, Simon, and said unto him, "We have found the Messiah," which is being interpreted the Christ. And he said unto, and he brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, "Thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas," which is being interpreted a stone. The day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip, and said unto him, "Follow me." Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip find Nathanael, somebody finding his brother again. He has followed Jesus Christ. And the next thing was, "My brother." Think about your brothers. Think about your sisters. Think about your family members. If they are not born again, take it upon you. This year, my family members must be born again. You don't need to ask God, if it's your will, let them be born again. It's the will of God for them to be born again. So take it upon yourself to fast and to pray and to reach out to them. They are the easiest people to reach out to, because they will listen to you. And especially when you are living the Christian life. You know, one thing with the grace of God is, once you have met the grace of God that's transformed your life, automatically you command respect. You want to talk even to your father, he will listen to you. But where there's no grace, you won't want to, you say, please, can I check? He will just look at you and laugh. But when the grace of God, you have truly found the grace of God, your siblings will listen to you when you want to preach to them. So this year, let's target our family members. We should not allow them go to hell. We should not allow them go to hell. Let's target our family members, just as we saw Andrew did. Just as we saw Philip did. Philip brought Nathaniel, his brother. Andrew brought Peter, his brother. And of course, you knew how Peter eventually became the leader of the apostles. He became a great instrument in the hands of God. He was the convert of his brother Andrew, who brought him to Christ. So that your brother that you think you have written off, this one is a drunkard, this one cannot be born again, don't be surprised. He can be a general overseer of a ministry. And he will even be pastor. God will so anoint him, because the grace of God does not necessarily follow the chronological spiritual age. You have been born again for 10 years, so I will have more grace than you that is born again for 2 years. It doesn't work like that. So let's target our family members. Number two, try to reach out to the relatives and neighbors around you, your friends and your neighbors around you. Don't take the gospel and cross countries with it when your next door neighbor has not had the gospel from your mouth. It's not good. You travel from one point to another. You live for evangelism. You take your Bible and you leave your next door neighbors, your estate neighbors. You live in the same estate. You live and they have never had the gospel from your mouth. Sometimes, why don't you preach to them? Maybe because we are not living the Christian life. They see us, they hear us quarrel with our wives. Sometimes they even come to settle the quarrel with our wives. And how will you take the Bible and preach to them? They see how our children behave, misbehave. They see all those things. So how do we preach to them? So sometimes that's the challenge we have. So what? Let's target them. Let's see how to reach out to the neighbors. And how do we do that? Let's look at an example in the Bible, how somebody reached out to his kinsmen and his neighbors successfully. Let's open our Bibles to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10. I'll read from verse 1 to verse 7, and I'll jump and read to verse 24, then verse 44 to 48. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, from verse 1. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms are come up for a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodgeth with one Simon a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. So far, verse 8. Then let's go to verse 24. I believe you know the story of Cornelius. Let's go to verse 24 and see what Cornelius did in reaching out to his kinsmen, to his friend. In verse 24, and the morrow, after they entered into Caesarea, and Cornelius waited for them, and he had called together his kinsmen and near friends to his house. The servant of God, Apostle Peter, was coming. He would not want to listen to Apostle Peter alone. he invited his kingsmen. He might have told them, please, I have a special lunch in my house today by 2 o'clock. Please come, a special lunch. I have a special guest. A man of God is coming to pray for us. Can you come? And they came, his kingsmen and his near friends. And look at what happened in verse 44. While Peter yet spake, that was a servant of God that came. While Peter yet spake, Cornelius had gathered his kinsmen and his friends. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which had the word, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they him to tarry 7 days. Look at the style Cornelius used here. We can apply that. Sometimes, yes, familiarity may make it difficult for us to reach out to our neighbors. Yeah, sometimes. Not as if you are not living the Christian life. Yes, you are living the Christian life. But you know, you chat, you play, and familiarity, it may be difficult for you. So what do you do? Apply this method of Cornelius. Prepare a special lunch. Some jollof rice, some chicken, and invite them. I have a special dinner today. By 7 p.m., or I have a special lunch in my house, but please try to come. Everything is ready. Just come for a special lunch. Don't eat in your house. Today's lunch is in my house. And you invite some 2-3 families. Yes, you may spend money, but I want to tell you, any single kobo spent for the sake of the gospel will not go unrewarded. You'll be rewarded for that. You may say, nobody got born again. No, they have heard the word of God. You should remember that Jesus Christ, when he was on earth, it was not always that he preached that everybody got born again. There are some places he preached, they rather wanted to stone him. So at least they had the gospel. The gospel, yes, is for salvation, but the Bible also tells us it's for a witness. They might not be born again, but it's a witness. They won't say they didn't hear, they had. So just invite some families and prepare a special lunch and invite the servant of God. Invite a pastor at your location, or invite a man of God, can pay his transport, or even within the city. Sometimes not some men of God, they are looking for opportunities to preach. True men of God, they don't even bother about transport, accommodation, whatsoever. And prepare a special lunch and invite those people, especially some of those high-ranking people that are difficult to reach. Maybe you are highly placed, God has blessed you, live in the estate where there are big men, everybody mind his business. And you prepare such for some 3, 4, 5 families and invite the man of God. And he comes to pray for them. I say, we're having a special prayer lunch. You can call it a prayer lunch. A man of God will come, have lunch with us and pray for us. Everybody wants prayers. He will come. And when the man of God comes to pray, he will want to read 1 or 2 verses. And you will not know what God can do. And what happened in the family of Cornelius can happen. As he preaches, everybody can get born again and even be filled with the Holy Ghost. Right there and then, Peter commanded them to be baptized. So we can use that method. Our neighbors, arrange a lunch meeting, arrange a dinner meeting, arrange a breakfast meeting. The people at their place of work. Maybe you are a boss at your place of work. God has blessed you, promoted you, you are a director at your place of work. A director wants to have a lunch meeting with all the employers of this department today. They will come. The director, our head of department wants to have lunch meeting with all the members of the department. And they will come, even those of the other religion, they will come. And as they come, you have prepared a servant of God who will come and preach. This method works. It has worked a lot in various places. People have heard the gospel through such means. People that you have invited them to come to church, they will not come. People that if you have carried your Bible and knock at the doors, they will not give you audience. But because it's a special lunch meeting and you prepare delicacies, special food, chicken and the rest, yes, you will spend money. Of course, Cornelius must have spent money. Cornelius must have prepared the lunch. Cornelius must have done some things and invited Peter. He would have accommodated Peter. Because look at in verse 48, the Bible says they prayed him to tarry. You think they would tarry? He would tarry and be sleeping on the floor? Maybe prepared a special accommodation. You think he would just be fasting throughout? He would be eating some special meal as a servant of God. So Cornelius would have also spent some money. But will you compare that money to the souls that God saved? Even if it's 1 million naira you spend and one soul gets saved, you can't compare 1 million naira to one soul. whatever you spend. So let's apply such a method. The third method we can apply is evangelistic visitation. Plan to travel and visit some relatives, some friends, some old classmates. There are some old classmates, maybe we parted in secondary school or in the universities, and you know where they are. Maybe occasionally you stumble on one another. And for long you have not met, you have just boycotted and forgotten about them. No, try to remember them. Give them a call. And specially prepare to go and visit them. A focused visitation, not just a turnaround visitation to go and discuss politics, to discuss the security challenge of this country. No, special visitation. Are you around? I'll be coming by such time to visit you with my family. Maybe you're a family man. You drive with your wife or maybe with your children to go and visit them. A special visitation, a prepared visitation, and you have prayed. And you have planned, and God has put some verses, some scriptures in your heart. And as you go, God will lead you on the what to say. And that could be the one of the greatest encounter of that family. Maybe you want to meet them in a situation where that was all they needed at that point in time. You go visit them, discuss with them, cheer them up, encourage them, pray with them. So let's plan that. Some maybe it may entail traveling out of the city. Prepare a special time, maybe traveling out of the city, out of the states, to go and visit just for a specific visitation. You want to go and visit this person, and the aim is to reach out with the word of God. Especially some of our friends or loved ones or people we know, you hear they are terminally ill. You hear, oh, such and such a person is sick. And you had the nature of the disease, this one you know that is terminally ill. He may die except divine intervention. Prepare to visit such a person. Your visitation may be all that is needed to prepare the person for eternity. As you visit, you pray for the person, you encourage the person, you share the word of God with the person, and the person may get born again. And as you leave, you hear, oh, the person have died. Within you, you'll be happy that, yes, you should reach out to the person that got born again. Or as you reach, you pray, the person may receive miracle. God may use you for a miracle of healing and heal the person. So evangelistic visitation, focused visitation. We see that in Luke chapter 1 from verse 39 to 56. We may not be reading because of our time. Then again, we see literature evangelism. Sometimes we neglect this aspect of evangelism. One of the greatest literature evangelism done on planet Earth today is by Jehovah Witness. I believe you have read Awake magazine. And this, they spend billions, or let me not say billions, millions of dollars, I think, to print this magazine and propagate and spread false gospel.
Sorry,
to billions, the entire actually. World.
Veronese, billion actually. Billions.
Sir?
Billions of dollars.
Billions, yeah.
They give it out free.
Billions of dollars.
Free. They don't buy. You don't they buy. Give
free. You see, every nook, you go to a remote village, you go and see Awake there. You wonder, how did Awake reach here? False gospel. And we that have the true gospel, you cannot spend a kobo to buy a Christian literature and give it out. How many Bibles have you given out since you got born again? You go to church, you see youths with tattered Bible. All you do is each retreat or each program you go, you buy a new Bible for yourself. Only you want to go to heaven. You have family members. You have given them every gift except the Bible. You have paid school fees for their children. You have bought Christmas clothes for them. Everything. You have bought bags of rice for them except the Bible. Are you doing well? There are some of these people you may not, it may be difficult to preach to them. Just buy the Bible and give them. You may think they will not read. I tell you they will read. I remember somebody I gave the Bible. Yeah. It was for a different religion. She sent a message to me and said she wanted to inform me that she read the Bible. And I've been praying for her. Just giving a Bible. Tracts. We have tracts. The ministry have tracts lying there. Sometimes people will not spend some little naira, some few little money to buy tracts. How much are these tracts? Sometimes you go to all those bookshops, Christian bookshops, you see tracts littered there as cheap as 10 naira. They will tell you 3 pieces of tracts, 10 naira. It's not for profits. How much does it actually mean to print those tracts? You think 3 tracts, 10 naira, will 10 naira buy tracts? They are just cost, maybe to maintain the printing and all those things, not for any profits. But Christian will not still buy and distribute it. We cannot support. So literature evangelism can go a very long way. You give to some places, people at the place of work, so you are ogas, or as we call it in Nigeria, you are bosses at the place of work, and all those difficult to reach people, give them literature. It's very, very important. Tracts, books. We have books, Divine Revelation there. You have a lot of all those things. We have CD. When we say literature, not just printed literature. We have recorded literature. We have CDs. We have all those things. Try to share them. They may not read it, but it's a witness to them. Just give it like that. Forget about whether they read it or not. You have done your part by giving. They may not read it themselves, but they will keep it where somebody else will read it. So literature, evangelism, let's take it very, very serious. Then again, the next one, number five, is scriptural passages sent through WhatsApp messages, through Messenger, and through all the social media. Sometimes you just sit and pray and get a scriptural verse and just send to somebody. It may not necessarily be verse or be born again. No, sometimes we missed it. We feel if you go out for evangelism, you must mention born again. If born again did not come out of your mouth, you have not preached. It's not always like that. Sometimes just send a verse of encouraging the person. You know the person is a sinner. You know he's not born again, but he's passing through challenge. Don't link the person's challenge to him living in sin. It's not always like that. We have believers who are holy and living, passing through challenges too. Sometimes worse challenges than sinners too. So don't link the challenge of a sinner because he's a sinner. If you link that way, you will give him a false hope. He will think, oh, as I get born again, my challenges will be over. And his being born again is not because he has had the gospel, he's convicted of sin. It's because you have told him, if you can give your life to Christ, your challenges will be over. And he will now, oh, say this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, he will say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner, forgive me. And tomorrow the challenges are still there. And sometimes the challenges even multiply. You say, since I accepted you as Jesus, my life has remained the same. In fact, it has even become worse because you gave him a false hope. You met him, get born again, your challenges will be over. Yes, challenges will be over, but that should not be the driving force of being born again. It should be conviction from sin and salvation to make it to heaven, salvation unto eternal life. So sometimes just a verse of encouragement to that you are maybe a colleague at the place where you are very close and you have noticed he's having a family challenge, just go and get a scripture verse that talks about his challenge and send it to him and just encourage him like that. It works. So scriptural passages. Then six is friendship evangelism. Sometimes have a target person. Create a good relationship with the person. The relationship can go on for days, for weeks, for months, even years, without you opening your mouth to preach to the person. Sometimes it can be like that. But you know you are praying and looking for an opportunity, and God will surely bring the opportunity. And you target the person and make and try to see how one day, prayerfully, God will bring the means and you discover you're able to preach to the person. And as you do that, you discover you'll be able to reach out to the person. So be friends with someone. Be friends. Don't be a lone ranger at the place of work. We have people, okay, maybe at your place of work, you are the only one born again. And because you are the only one born again, you don't laugh with any other person. You are not a friend to anybody. You come alone. Once you come, pastor has come. You are just alone. You don't laugh with anybody. You don't talk with anybody. You don't discuss with anybody. You don't engage in any other thing that is not spiritual. Your engagement with people is spiritual. It's not always like that. You remember Jesus Christ went for a wedding in Canaan? That was not a spiritual gathering. It was a social gathering, a wedding. He was invited. And in fact, in that wedding, there was wine, alcoholic wine. It was when the alcoholic wine finished, they ran out of wine. The Bible said they came to him and he turned water into wine. That the master of the ceremony said, tested the wine and said, we are drunken with bad wine and you have not brought the good wine. So he went to a social gathering. So sometimes try to be socialize with people. Be friends to people. That doesn't make you a sinner. Socialize at your place of work, socialize. As a student in the school, socialize, make friends. But so that is by then that they will see the light. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, let your light so shine before men, not before wood or before some. When you don't socialize, you don't meet, how will they see? The Bible said, so that they will see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. And finally, before we pray, another method actually proven to work very well is showing love to people. Just show love. You don't need to preach to the person. There are some people, Once you open your mouth to say, I want to preach to you, you become their enemies. In fact, you close the door, they will not even listen to you. They will stop greeting you because you make an effort to preach to them. They will stop and try to be a brother to them. Act like a father to them, like a mother to them, like a sibling to them. Show them love that they have not experienced before. Be concerned about them. Send message, greet, how are you doing? Knock at their door. Find out, oh, have you had food today? Can we go out today and eat? Please invite them for lunch. Just love. Don't preach to them. Just show love. Don't preach. Don't open the Bible. There are some people, that's why we bring them to Christ. Don't even open the Bible. Just let them just see love. Or you take them out, you go eat, come back, oh, they are happy and all those things. You are neighbors and maybe you have a car and his car is faulty. Oh, why not? Take my car, have it, no problem. You know, sometimes it's difficult to give somebody your car. You'll be surprised. Ah, you are giving him, no, take it and ride, no problem. You even foil the car. He drives and comes back. Maybe as he was coming, he hit something and he's feeling bad. It's no problem, no problem, don't worry. And you are just, he'll be like, which type of person is this? He'll just be studying you. Then tomorrow again, oh, maybe the wife put to bed and all those things, you go and do a lot of shoppings and all those things and buy and bring. He'll just be looking at you, which type of person is this? You keep showing love. Look at the Bible says in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Sometimes this is where we miss it, especially we who are holiness preachers. We feel when you have contact with somebody, you must mention born again from your mouth. If you don't mention born again, you have not preached. It doesn't always work like that. Just showing love. Pray for the person without necessarily preaching to the person. Jesus Christ did that. We learned from our master. There were people that came to Jesus with need. He didn't preach to them. And he knew they were sinners, but he just prayed for them, gave them miracle, and left. The miracle brought them to Christ. Some, they even got miracle and left. We didn't hear whether they later got born again or not. So somebody is sick. Sometimes we form the habit when we go to preach to the person, when we go to pray for the person in the sick bed, we must preach to the person. If you are led to preach to the person first, fine. But don't control the Holy Spirit. Don't, it's like it must be by preaching, born again, then miracle. It's not always like that. Miracle can come to a sinner. Many people receive miracle in the Bible as sinners. Even now, in crusade ground, sinners come, not born again, they receive miracle. And it's a miracle that eventually brings them to Christ. Some, they don't get born again immediately, even with the miracle. Eventually, they get born again. So you just go pray with the person. The person is in need, help the person. Look at Romans chapter 12. I read from verse 9 to 21. Romans chapter 12 from verse 9. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. In honor, preferring one another. Don't see yourself as the best person in the estate. Don't see yourself, maybe God has blessed you and you are in terms of work, at your, where you live, at your neighborhood, you are the boss, or you are a senior civil servant, while others are not, or your business seems to be doing better than others. No, the Bible says, in honor, preferring one another, not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayers, distributing to the necessities of the saints, giving to hospitality, bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not, rejoice with them that rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind, one toward another, mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lie in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, said the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink, for in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Love is a language that everybody on earth understands. Everybody wants to be loved, no matter how wicked the person is. Everybody understands love. When you show true love, genuine love, people will know and they will understand. And nobody will resent you for loving him. No. People can resent you for preaching the gospel. They can hate you for preaching the gospel, but nobody will hate you for love. So there are some people, the best approach is love. Don't open their Bible. Show them love. They are sick, visit them. They are in need. So look for an opportunity to show them love. Target, when they are in need, you sense there's lack of food in this house. You may not have. We don't give because we have. You know, sometimes we make a mistake. When we see somebody giving us, somebody saying 5,000 to you, say, oh, he has so much money that he has even given me 5,000. No, it's giving out of love. It's not out of much money. So it's not necessarily that you have. You sense within you, this family is like there's no food. And sometimes God will make you to know. Maybe you met with a person in market and you saw him buying 10 naira palm oil and buying one measure of rice. And you know that it's a family of six. You know that there's challenge in this family. You just go and buy 25 kg of rice. As you are coming by, just drop there and say, I just feel like giving you this. God bless you. And you didn't preach to the person. Tomorrow again, you see another and you keep doing that. You keep doing that alone will break the person. And one day, you may open your mouth to preach. You have already, it's like you have watered the ground. Sometimes you may not open your mouth to preach. That alone will bring conviction and will break him and will say, no, no, this one is a Christian. Have you lived with people that they will look at you and testify and say, no, if I've ever lived with a Christian, this person is a Christian. Can they say that about you? The love, the concern you have for people. Why are you the type that don't care about people? You are not concerned. Your neighbor is sick. You are not concerned. Your neighbor got sick, admitted in the hospital and discharged. You are not aware. Why? Because you don't have a show of concern. You are not even aware. He traveled for 1 week and came back and you are not aware. And you are in the same company. Why? Because you don't care. Whether he's there or he's not there, you don't even care. You never asked. Oh, I've not seen you for 2 days. What happened? You never asked. You just meet and greet. You know, we live in a society like that now. It's unfortunate. And then those who are growing in the village, almost everybody in your area, we call it Angwa, everybody there, you know by name, you know their houses, you know everything. When one is sick, you know. But now, in a state of just 8 flats, you will not know the next neighbor's name. You will not even know. The name, the children will not even know their names. Why? Because everybody is busy in his house. The children are watching cartoon. You're busy, just come out, enter your car and zoom off. That is not the Christian life. Show love. And when you show this love, by that, the heart of the person is opened. The day he hears about Christianity, he hears the gospel. It may not be from you. He just goes out and somebody is preaching and you know that, yes, I lived with a Christian. And this thing this person is preaching is true. And that can lead the person to salvation. It may be while you are there, or it may be years after you have parted. The person will get born again because of the life he saw you live. Because of the love he saw you. You pay your children's school fees. And your neighbor's children are at home. Why? Because no school fees. They send them out of school. And you don't care. You have not made effort to even, oh, what happened? Oh, my children no school fees. Oh, how much is the school fees? Okay, can you take this and support? Or rent. Your neighbor is harassed by the landlord because of rent. And you don't show some love, show some concern. Sometimes you may not have, but the concern where which you show, such that if you had, the neighbor know that if you had, you would have paid the rent. Or sometimes you support, God has blessed you. And you just got some money. And you support, how much is the rent? Oh, it's 100,000 naira. Take this 50,000 naira. If you have, God has blessed you to give it free, fine. If not, you say, okay, take this 50,000, pay. Anytime you get, you can return it. And sometimes the heart at which you get, God will bless you such that you don't even need it again. Just tell the person, no, that 50,000, don't worry, just have it. The person will be so touched, will be so broken. And their heart is ready for salvation, ready for. So the day you want to open your mouth, even when that one day, don't be surprised, the person will tell you, please, I want to join you. I want to follow you to your church. I see Christ in you. And God will bless us in Jesus' name. Finally, John chapter 13, verse 17. Finally, I will pray. John chapter 13, I'll read verse 17. If ye know these things, happy. Blessed are ye if you do them. We have known them. We are not hearing all this for the first time. It's not a strange message or a new message. No. What have we been doing then? The Bible says, if ye know these things, happy are ye. Blessed are ye if ye do them. God will give us grace to do them in Jesus' name. Remember, we started by saying the greatest work we can do for God is evangelism, is soul winning. God will help us to be involved in evangelism. And this year, 2020, we introduce some spices in our evangelistic outreach. We try to increase, not watering the gospel. No, the gospel we don't modify it, but some new methods of reaching out. And God will give us wisdom to know when to apply, how to apply, and in what situation. God will give us wisdom and give us grace to apply them in Jesus' name. Let's go to the Lord in prayers.
Give us strength, help us cope.